jobs. What's your issues on the jobs currently within Mecklenburg County, and how can we increase the employment?
Well, I think with jobs, we, you know, during the recession and other things, we lost a lot of jobs. I think we're starting to see jobs come back now, but we're talking about different sectors. The economy of Mecklenburg County has changed. We're more into the energy sector now. Mm-hmm. With there again, we talk about STEM curriculum. That's mm-hmm. very important to be able to fill those jobs. Manufacturing is coming back in the area, but it's not the traditional manufacturing that we've seen presently before this great divide. Now it's more technical. We're more heavily dependent upon robotics and those things. Okay. And so I think, let me go back to the point of STEM and research and development. And those skills are going to be what drives the workforce mm-hmm. for the future, not only in this region, but across the state.
Okay.
Yeah.
One of the biggest issues I see within our Charlotte community is poverty. What is your feelings on how can we improve that?
Well, poverty is a very, very tough issue, Paul. Yes, I think that there's a couple of steps that we can take. First of all, we have to look at education. Education mm-hmm. is the great equalizer. But I always say education, but then I talk about right education, mm-hmm. how to be properly educated so that we can start to be competitive globally as a community. Mm-hmm. We need to have a greater emphasis on small business development among our particular community. We are the greatest consumers, but we produce very little. So we need to turn the paradigm around mm-hmm. and make sure that we understand that we need to be a little bit more self-reliant. We need to build businesses in our communities. We need to emphasize those skills, those real world skills that are gonna give us that lift, but also education is the fundamental key to pulling yourself out of poverty. And so we have to be educated, but we have to be educated properly.
Correct, all right. Okay, I know we talk a lot about the senior citizens that we have. Is there enough programs for our senior citizens in this community?
Well, we can never have enough programming to make sure that our senior citizens live a great quality mm-hmm. of life. I think what I've seen in Raleigh is that there's been somewhat of a disconnect between the majority party and their priorities, and I think so. We struggle goodly to try to fund areas like health and human services, like senior care services, and I think so. That's an ongoing debate, but I think for just in Mecklenburg County, that we fared better than most communities, right. And there's always room for improvement. But I think that we're a senior friendly city and county, and so I'm very proud of that, and I look forward to just enhancing that experience as we go along.
And I know you're really vocal about having a lot of programs for these senior citizens in our community, and I applaud you for that.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I got my start. I was appointed to the Charlotte Senior Centers Board.
Okay.
And so that was my first kind of dip into what was going on in Charlotte. And, you know, I have a lot of elderly family members, and so that was a very important issue for me. And so I will continue to advocate for senior care and all of the things that come with it.
I know we talk about unemployment, but how important is it for people to become entrepreneurs, small business owners?
Well, I think it's very important. And let me touch on a point about unemployment. I think that we could really start to turn the paradigm of unemployment around if we have our traditional workers who those industries have kind of left and have kind of morphed into some other things. We really need to have a higher emphasis on our community college. We have a great community college here, Central Piedmont, so that we can retrain those workers into those particular disciplines that they may have worked in the past, but it's just the methodology and the dynamics of that industry has changed. And so they need to kind of catch up and refresh their skills so that they can become viable workers for the new dynamic.
Veterans program. Mm-hmm. Now, I know we have a lot of veterans in our community. Why is it so important that we give back to the veterans because of what they've done for our country?
Well, there again, the veterans affairs, we really need to put a special emphasis on our veterans. They sacrificed a lot. You know, the saying that all gave some, but some gave all, right, is very relevant, and we really need to do better as it relates to our veterans, as it relates to getting them care for mental issues, and veteran homelessness is a critical area that we really, as a city and as a state and as a nation, we really need to do all we can to make sure that we don't have any person that has given us such a great sacrifice be somewhere where they're not stable in a stable and warm home. Right. So those are some of the things that I'm really passionate about, some of the things that I feel are priorities for our government as we go forward.
As the representative, what do you feel is one of the biggest issues that we have in our community, and how do we solve it?
Well, we have so many issues. Right. One of the biggest issues that, and I keep going back to it, mm-hmm. is how we properly educate and we prepare our workforce for these 21st century jobs and those things that are going to make us globally competitive. The world is so intertwined with the internet and other things. It's almost like India and China and Bangladesh are right around the corner from us down on a trade street. And so if I would say one thing that we really need to concentrate on is that education, that fundamental base of education that's going to make us competitive and give us a superlative advantage as we go forward with in the new economy.
Now, I know you've been the representative for two terms?
Three terms. This will be my third term coming up.
How many more times do you want to be representative, and do you look forward to possibly moving up to possibly congressman?
Well, Paul, that's always a thought in the back of my mind. We really looked at a possibility of running for Congress when the whole situation with Congressman Watt came with the appointment. We looked at it and we researched it, kind of dialed back on it because we just didn't feel like it was the right time at that time, given the circumstances. I feel good being the state representative. I feel that I've done some good work. I will continue to do some good work, and we will, me and my trusted people, we will take a look at all possibilities, and we'll make a decision that's best for us, and also best for the people of the mm-hmm. district and North Carolina. So thank you for that question.
No problem.
I get that more so now than I have been at any other time, because this is my third term, and I think that I've made some great inroads from the time that I've been there as a freshman to now. Mm-hmm. And I'm just trying to fulfill the mission that I have right now.
Correct. What do you feel has been the most beneficial thing for you being in office?
Well, I think the most beneficial thing for me has been the relationships that I've forged on both sides of the aisle, as well as the constituents and the citizens that I've come in contact with. It's really helped, the experiences helped me kind of expand and grow as a person, helped me really fulfill my mission. I have a servant's heart. Okay. So this is almost like a ministry. When I was a little boy, you know, the elders used to tell me, "Well, you're going to be a great minister." I said, "Well, you know, when I think back, I said, well, this is a ministry to me. It's a ministry that I love, and I just love advocating and for the people of North Carolina. I think it's a very high honor."
And you're doing a great job, you know. And it's not, we see your face on the news all the time, you know, and that's a great thing to know that you're getting involved with issues that's going on.
Right.
You know, that's one of the biggest things that we look for in a representative.
Right.
Someone that's going to be there and speak out about these issues that we have.
Right. Well, you know, I take the philosophy of that, you know, I'm here to do all that I can to advocate for the concerns of my constituents and the citizens of North Carolina. And even though I find myself in kind of a partisan disadvantage, I still do the best I can to represent the concerns of the people. I advocate, I work across the aisle. I mean, because government, politics, or anything, life is about relationships. That's and true. So we have to find a way to build those relationships, whatever the partisan composition of the body is, so that we can effectively advocate and have success.
Representative Moore, if someone wanted to get in contact with you, how would they do that?
They can reach me at my Raleigh office. The number there is 919-733-5606. Or they can email me at Rodney@nclegnet.
One more question. How does your family feel about you and being in office?
Well, I've been great. They've been very supportive and understanding. They have to be understanding considering the schedule that we have. And so I've gotten some great support, and they're proud of me. And that just helps me fuel myself when I get times where I get a little weak. And you know, they're my rock. And so my faith and my family are my motivating factors to press on.
Representative Moore, we're coming to a close. I'd like to thank you for coming on the show, and anytime you want to come back.
Thank you, Paul.
More than welcome.
I appreciate
back.
You.
Oh, no problem,
appreciate
sir.
You. Absolutely.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have Representative Moore. You be encouraged. Thank you.